Christmas brings joy, Christmas brings cheer, and our spirits are lifted as the blessed season is here. It's my tremendous honor to welcome you all to this virtual program to celebrate Christmas with the Goodwill community. Christmas is not just a festival, it's a way of life which is taught to us by Jesus. The miracle child of God was born among men to fulfill God's plan for the salvation of mankind. I deem it my pleasure to have with us our chairman and our most esteemed bishop, the guide and mentor of all CSI institutions, Right Reverend Dr. Prasanna Kumar Samuel, who moves multitudes with his inspiring sermons, will now bring the Christmas greetings and would share his message about the miracle child of Bethlehem.
Respected Principal, Mrs. Nyanamani Franklin, members of the Board of Management, Heads of the institution, Mr. Salomon Raji, the officer, the treasurer of the diocese, teaching and the non-teaching staff. After Mrs. Nyanamani made her remarks, I thought no need for me to give a message, because three-fourths of the message she already covered, and the person was doing MC from the beginning, she has been talking only sermons. And I'm sure that you know, many sermons have come this morning and this evening, and many more will come. So when she said greetings, I thought, okay, good, that you know, I need not do a message. But after greetings, she said message also. So let me take this time to wish you well and God's blessings. We have gone through uncertainties. We have gone through difficult times. We have lost our dear ones. We have done many things. What is in store for us in the next year, we really do not know. With this Omicron and you know, Alpha, Beta, Gamma, and many things are keep on coming in, and we really don't know where exactly the world is going. In a situation of this nature, Christians seem to be celebrating the birthday of Jesus Christ, and here in this institution, in a smaller way, although the children are not here, the students are not here, you as staff, you are gathered here this evening to celebrate. To celebrate a miracle child. To celebrate a child who is very much vulnerable. To celebrate a child and his birth. What exactly we have in our minds when we think in terms of a miracle child? Because in Isaiah chapter 43 verse 19, behold, I do a new thing, now it shall spring forth, shall ye not know it? I am bringing a new thing altogether, I am bringing a new chapter, I am bringing a new millennium, I am bringing something new, and that newness is going to come only through this child, nothing else. Because I am the Lord, that is my name. The former things have taken place, and new things I declare, 42 Isaiah. I, the Lord, do not change, so you, the descendant of Jacob, are not destroyed, Malachi 3:6. There are many verses which we can really quote, and you know, we can also say that, you know, we have a new dawn and new beginning, and the new dawn is rooted in the child, Jesus Christ, who happens to be a miracle child. And his mission on this earth was nothing but characterized by new and strange things. And in the New Testament, and very especially in the Gospel portions, you will categorically listen to these statements where people were making. We never saw it in this fashion. The way that he was teaching, the way that he was preaching, people were alarmed, people were astonished, and they looked at and they made this statement by saying, we never saw it in this fashion. And they are also saying in Luke 5:26, we have seen strange things today. Because he seemed to be driving away the demons. He had power over the nature. He is calming down the sea. He is doing strange things. A child was born in the manger. What manner of man is this? Matthew 27. So the hope of Christmas is described in the passages that were read to us. In the context of Isaiah chapter 9 that was read this evening, is the darkness of the circumstances of God's people. God's people have been abandoned. God's people are fending for themselves. God's people do not know where to go. So Isaiah talks about gloom and anguish and contempt. The gloom and anguish because of the uncertainties, because we really do not know what is in store for us. But in the gloom or in the uncertainties, in the darkness, he also prophesying that God and God's people are in trouble. The great nation of Assyria was threatening to invade. These were not nice people. And to that people, Isaiah was saying, there's going to be a light. And that light will dawn only through a child. They were coming ultimately as God's judgment on the nation for their unfaithfulness. Even in the midst of judgment, Isaiah had a word from God to the faithful remnant that remained inside the largely unfaithful nation. The word was about a light coming in the darkness. Don't you think that everything was lost? There is a ray of hope. There is always some positivity. Keep that ray of hope and light. We are unfaithful, but God is faithful. We are sinful, but God saves sinners. We are in darkness, but the light is coming. In the former time there was gloom, but in the latter time is glory. From gloom to glory, and that is the gospel that the Christ child, the miracle child, can give us. Because in verse 6 of the same passage, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. As we try to understand this child, there is nothing in this world weaker than a human child. Animal offsprings are more self-sufficient. For example, think of the baby sea turtles. The baby sea turtles. They hatch on the beach and immediately are thrust into a life and death race to the waters. We really do not know how many really survive, but they had to survive in water before they even have time to look around the world. They are off and running. But a human child, it says, it lays in a crib for a long time, crying for milk, sleeping 24 hours a day. And you know, it is utterly vulnerable. Anything could happen to a child, because the child has no defense, no immunity at all. Any disease can attack this child. But how is it that when God waged war on this world, he sent a baby? And that baby we call a miracle baby, because through that baby, the whole world is going to be saved. What is God doing now? He is overturning our expectations, and in the way that we expected God to intervene in human history. God has ordered the world such that weakness overcomes power, foolishness overcomes wisdom, and a child defeats the evil one. What we find finally is the answer to all that has ever made us afraid. The anxiety we have carried all these many years. Ever since COVID-19, so much of anxious moments. So many things are happening around us, we are not sure. Looking at the TV or looking at the news, what is next? What is next? We have carried every fear we have nursed. Every difficulty we have faced is answered in one single person, a child. A child is to be born. In verse 6 again, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. So from the child, everything begins. The government of this world doesn't ultimately land on us, but on Jesus. Because he has been born to shoulder the government. If God can bring the entire creation to existence out of nothing, he can create any chaos into cosmos. From nothing, he created the whole world through his word. Because God said, let there be, there was. An ordinary Jewish woman, maiden, to become pregnant with the Son of God in human form. God became incarnate to save sinners. That is the miracle child that we are talking. This is the miracle of miracles from the Bible's Christmas story. It is a story of how the one eternal infinite God took on human flesh and blood, becoming Emmanuel, God with us. So this miracle child is God with us till the end of the age. Because in John 3:16, all of us know, he loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son. So again, this child loves the world, loves humanity, so he came down to this world. There are three things that I would like to share and complete my message this evening. Number one, through this child comes deliverance. Matthew 1:21. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Deliverance not only from their sinful nature, deliverance or liberation. Here is a child who is going to deliver. Jesus had to be taken into Egypt to be delivered from the hate and evil of Herod. And time and again, God's hand has been intervened in Jesus' life. And likewise, Jesus is our deliverance from all that the world holds us and keep us from becoming all that God wants us to be. So he delivers us, and that child is a miracle child because that child delivers us. Secondly, this is a child going to bring about development. Another miracle of Christmas is development. God sent his son, Jesus, to Egypt for his development. Think of it, and you are able to see there is physical development, there is mental maturity, there is psychological development. He became a man. And then after fasting, he was driven into the wilderness. And 3.5 years of his ministry, because he was trained in Egypt. And you are able to see the development in Christ, because God planned it and Jesus was able to fulfill it. So the miracle of Christmas is not only about our deliverance, but also about our development. It's about spiritual development, psychological development. It is about all the education, every development that the Christ child can bring about. And that is what Christmas is all about. Thirdly, it is not only deliverance, it is not only the development, it is determination. The determination of the Christ child or the miracle child is not to see him in the cradle, but to go up to the cross. Christmas is about the determination to stay on track with the mission and purpose that God has enshrined in the gospel. And that gospel of love, gospel of compassion, gospel of acceptance, and that gospel always tells us that we need to transcend boundaries and you need to be determined. Mary and Joseph understood that Jesus had a purpose and a mission. Although Joseph wanted to keep her away, the angel came and warned Joseph and he accepted. Mary and Joseph were determined to follow the will of God. Although this is a miracle child, the human parents, as you might call, they were submitting themselves to the will of God, so that the determination of God the Father, the determination that was taken in Genesis chapter 3 after Adam and Eve commit the sin, that God would send a deliverer through a child, and that child is Jesus, and the determination came to be fulfilled. So the miracle of Christmas is about being determined to follow the directions of God's will and submit ourselves to God's care. It was Mary who was willing to submit to God's will, Joseph willing to submit to God's will, the shepherds were willing to come and listen after listening to Gabriel, The three wise people, looking at the stars, they were willing and they were determined to come and give the offertory, come and give the gifts to this little one. So all this determination put the miracle child in its center by saying, this is the child in whom God is well pleased. To complete my message this evening, a little story. Years ago, there was a mining town in the US. And this mining town had a very bad experience. Roaring camp, noisy people, notorious characters, all these people were there living in this mining town. Murders, fights, thefts, and drunkenness. There was no way that they were able to control these guys. The only woman there was a Native American, Cherokee Sal was her name. But you know, she was trying to change the mindset of these people living in that town, but she failed herself. But when she gave birth to a child, she dies and the child survives. The baby survived and quite healthy the child was. The miners, however, were faced with quite a dilemma. And the dilemma was, what shall we do with the baby? Father is not there, mother died, the baby has become an orphan. They made a crib out of an old box lined with dirty rags. The box was not good enough or clean enough to hold a baby. So a cradle was made. And they brought that cradle 80 miles from a different town. And they placed the baby in. Beautiful blankets were bought. And you know, everything was beautiful and they kept that beautiful child in the cradle. The miners noticed that the shack where the baby was kept was filthy. So they washed the floor, walls and the ceiling, and they changed the whole atmosphere of the place where the baby was staying. Nice curtains were installed on the windows. Life began to change in the mining area. Brutality ceased. Every day the baby was taken to the entrance of the mine, and all the miners would see the child's face and they'd go into the mines. The miners decided the entrance to the mine was ugly, so they planted beautiful gardens there. These hardened men loved to pet and touch the baby, but their hands were dirty. Soon the gentle soul sold out for soap. Life in Roaring Camp had completely changed because of the baby. These hardened miners had given up their nasty, profane ways, all for the love of this little baby. The whole city changed because of this beautiful child who became an orphan, whom the miners took care. If you and I have come here this evening to look at this miracle child, the good news is that in a baby, there is life-changing, redemptive power. And that we call Jesus. Wishing you God's blessings as you worship this God, as you understand this little one, Jesus, and you know this miracle child, because God had to rest on this child in order to save humankind. God bless you. And wishing you God's blessings, and may this child bring unity and togetherness. May this child change the attitude that we have and the mindset that we have in order to love one another, to take care for one another, to share all the joys like that mining town. That little child was able to change their whole system and the atmosphere. The miracle child Jesus has changed the world, but it is for us. In the busy schedule that we have, in the busyness of the sound that we are attracted to, the little small voice of Jesus still calling us, my dear daughter, my dear son, I still love you. I came down to this world leaving the heavenly above, the golden place, and come to this earthly place. I was not taking my birth in a kingly palace, but I have chosen to be a poorer person in a manger. When everybody abandoned me, you are there to take care of me. May that be your attitude, that we'll spend our time with the orphans, with those less fortunate, for those people whom COVID had been very hard on them, so that our love during this time will be expressed to those children and to those people, so that we'll be able to say, this miracle child touched me, that I was able to touch another person, his life journey. So it will be a chain of reaction that will take place, so that there will be change everywhere. God bless you, and thank you for inviting me, and amen.
The time of joy and celebration of God's greatest gift to mankind, His Son, Jesus Christ, being born into this world as Emmanuel. And today, it is a joy to have each of you with us this evening, as we celebrate our carol service through our nativity play, The Miracle Child. God's word in John 1 verse 19 says, "The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world." The light speaks of the light of His truth, the light of His word, the light of eternal life. Those who perceive the true light will never walk in spiritual darkness. And to send this true light into the world, God sent His only Son into this world to be born as a baby to redeem mankind. We are in that special time of the year once again, a season of joy, of peace, and of glad tidings, as we celebrate the birth of Christ the King, the Redeemer of mankind.
Hi Tracy.
Hello Jenny. Can we go out for a walk? It's a beautiful day. What are your plans this weekend?
Nothing much, but I have to go for shopping and buy lots and lots of stuff. Christmas is around the corner and we've got to enjoy the holiday season. I'm just looking forward for those late night parties, hanging out with friends, and to enjoy every bit of it. After all, Christmas is all about making merry. Don't you think so?
Will you be free this Saturday?
Yes, I guess.
Well, would you like to come over to our church to witness the Christmas play?
Oh, come on. Don't be so hooked on to all those traditional stuff. We've got to enjoy.
No, Jenny, you're wrong. You're missing on the true purpose of Christmas. And I am sure you'll enjoy and experience the true meaning of it. So So I'll be waiting for you in the church. See you at 6 in the evening.
Goodbye.
Bye.
See ya.
Merry Christmas. We welcome each one of you to the Nativity Show of Goodwill Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that all of you are here for our Christmas play. So sit back and relax. Hope this show will have a tremendous impact in your lives.
There's a special and magical connection between children and Christmas, which is the most wonderful time of the year.
I don't want a lot for Christmas. I don't care about the presents underneath the Christmas tree. I just want you for my own, more than you could ever know. Make my wish come true.
Oh,
beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Through Him all things were made. Without Him nothing was made that has been made. God Almighty had a wonderful plan to redeem mankind, and He loved the world so much that He sent His only Son to save the world. This wonderful promise of God was foretold by many prophets.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on His shoulders, and He'll be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
It's a verse that brings great comfort to all who hear it.
But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from ancient times.
Stop.
In Jewish eschatology, the Messiah is a future Jewish king from David's line who is expected to be anointed with holy anointing oil and rule the Jewish people during the Messianic age and the world to come. The Jews, God's chosen people, believe that the Messiah would come and save them, so they desperately long for the arrival of the Messiah who would put an end to their sufferings.
Your taxes are due. If you fail to pay them, you'll be taken to the trial and put in prison.
Please give us 2 more days. We will repay.
Hereafter, you'll be my slave. Do as you're told.
Teacher, I bought a good kid. Nothing wrong. No blemish. See? Spotless. This one is good.
Teacher, I have a question about the Messiah. I have studied the Torah every day.
A shepherd wants to learn?
Yes. Do you believe that the Messiah will set us free from the Roman occupation?
Yes. He'll be a strong ruler and his reign will make a great difference. You brought this animal which is wounded. How can offer this for a perfect sacrifice? You wonder why the Messiah has not come. People like you keep him away because of your stains. If you come here next time without a perfect lamb, I'll banish all of you from the marketplace.
The Jews expected the Messiah to be a military figure who would fight the Romans and drive them out.
But God had a different and perfect plan for mankind to send his only son as a sacrificial lamb, as the word of God in John 1:29 says, "Behold, the Lamb of God which takes away the sins of the world." And so, God chose a young virgin called Mary who would be the mother of the sacrificial lamb. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophet Isaiah. The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. The word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, John 1:14.
A long time ago, in a faraway town called Nazareth, there lived a girl called Mary. She was beautiful and full of love, and she wanted to love God a lot.
Here comes Mary.
Do you know what? Mary got engaged to Joseph the carpenter.
Joseph? You mean the son of Jacob? Yes, Joseph the carpenter. This is the bracelet he gave me.
Oh, it's so lovely.
Your happiness is shown on your face, aren't you?
I have got to hurry.
And God sent the angel Gabriel to proclaim the good news to Mary.
Greetings, most favored one. The Lord is with you. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. You will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and shall save his people from their sins.
How shall this be, since I know not a man?
The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the child will be holy and be called the Son of God.
I am the Lord's servant. Let what you have said be done to me.
Thank you. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's house and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greetings, the baby leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit.
Mary, I have been longing to see you.
How did you know?
Who told you?
A messenger from God. He also told me another thing.
Blessed are you among the women, and blessed is the child you will bear.
But why am I so favored that the mother of Lord should come to me?
As soon as I hear the sound of your greeting, the baby in my womb leapt for joy.
This is how the birth of Jesus came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to put her away privily. And after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said,
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and decided to take Mary as his wife. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was the governor of Syria, and everyone went to his own town to register.
Listen, ye people, listen! Emperor Caesar Augustus has ordered a census to be taken throughout the Roman Empire
Joseph was a descendant of David, he went to register with Mary, who was with child. When Mary and Joseph arrived at Bethlehem, things didn't look too good at all. There were so many other people to be counted that all hotels and inns seemed to be full. There was no room anywhere.
Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea to Bethlehem, the town of David. Because he belonged to the house and line of David, he went there to register with Mary.
Gosh, it's busy these days. We're completely booked up.
So are we. I am glad. Caesar wanted to find out how many people were living here. It has been great for business.
Excuse me. I was wondering if you have a room where my wife and I can stay for the night.
Sorry, we are all booked up. There's no room. You will have to go somewhere else.
But we have tried every inn in Bethlehem. You are our last hope. Please help us. My wife is going to have a baby very soon. She can't stay out in the cold.
Father, the poor lady is in a trouble. Can't we give them a room in a stable?
Yes, there is a plenty of room in the stable.
Yes, the stable would be a shelter if you can't find a place anywhere else.
Oh, thank you. May God reward you for your kindness.
Come along with me.
God had prepared a place of shelter, a shrine in which His Son can find honor and worship, a womb within the world in which He can be born. Here shall His glory be revealed. Thus, fulfilling the prophecies, Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem in Judea. Multitudes of heavenly hosts praised God and rejoiced at the Savior's birth. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace, goodwill towards men.
Thank you.
Now, around Bethlehem, there were lots of little hills where sheep used to graze. The shepherds who looked after them had to sleep out in the open at night, taking in turns to stay awake, because that was when the sheep were in most danger from foxes and wolves.
Doesn't the sky look really lovely tonight?
Yes, I have never seen so many stars, and they're so bright.
Simeon, it's your turn today to keep watch over the sheep and watch out for the wolves.
What about my dinner?
You can have it later on.
Come on, let's warm ourselves and have dinner.
I can hear something. I see something bright.
Oh, Simeon, allow us to sleep a little. You are so stupid.
He's good for nothing. Impertinent fellow.
What should you describe about the coming of the Messiah?
Please believe me, they look like heavenly beings. They are getting closer and closer.
Do not be afraid. I have great news for you. Today Jesus has been born. He is the savior of the world. You will find him lying in a manger in a stable in Bethlehem. Just follow the stars and it will take you there. And don't worry about your sheep, because the Lord will look after them.
Echo.
Yes, the Messiah has finally come. Thank you, Lord. I'm able to walk. He has healed me.
Oh, Simeon is able to walk. He's limping no more.
Thank you, Lord.
Praise be to the Lord. The Messiah will set us free.
Come on, lads. Let's go to spread the good news and worship the Savior.
That the Messiah has been born.
The Messiah has been born. The Prince of Peace has come at last.
But how did you know we are here?
While we were watching over a sheep, the whole sky was lit up with angels, and one of them told us you were here.
The angels were singing in the sky, saying glory to God the highest. I have never seen anything so beautiful.
We have been waiting for a long time.
We were terrified. They told us not to be afraid, that Jesus, the Savior of the world, has been born.
Meanwhile, some way off, three wise kings and their servants were making their way through the night. They had been traveling for months, walking or riding their camels thousands of miles. They came from different parts of the world and had met by chance. As they traveled along, following a bright star which had appeared in the sky. Because they were wise men, they realized that the star was a sign that the king of the world had been born.
Oh, May we introduce ourselves, friends? We are the Magi from the East. We read the meaning of the stars. We have seen a new star in the sky. It signifies the birth of a great ruler. We follow the star as it moves, and it has led us to this house. We've come to honor the newborn king.
We are highly honored to receive you in our humble abode.
At last, we've found you. Our search was not in vain. Here is my gift for the Savior, a casket of gold.
I bring you a gift from my native land, frankincense. I give it to you, Jesus, with all my heart.
And here is my gift, Myrrh, a precious spice from the Orient. We are so blessed to be here with you. And so, we want to give you this gift on behalf of all the people of the world to say that you are the only king.
Thank you. Your words are strange and hard to understand. May God guide you safely to home.
Farewell, my friends. May God be with you.
Oh,
Did you like the play, Jenny?
Yes, of course. It was mind-blowing. All this while I thought Christmas was fun and frolicking. But now, I have realized the true meaning of Christmas. That God sent His only Son to save the world, and especially a sinner like me. Am I so worthy of His love, Tracy?
Yes. Scripture says in Romans 5:8, but God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
But will He accept me? I have led such a wayward life.
Yes, of course. God loves sinners. God's word in 1 Timothy 1:15 says, Christ Jesus came to this world to save sinners, of whom I am worse.
But what should I do to experience this wonderful gift?
All you have to do is invite Him into your heart. Repent and confess your sins. Accept Him as your Lord and Savior.
Oh, I'm so glad. It's so simple. I already feel His peace engulfing in.
I promise you, Jenny, your life won't be the same again as you have accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior.
Thank you, Tracy, for making this Christmas a meaningful one. I'm looking forward for my new walk with the Savior.
Thank you, Lord, for coming into this world to save us. It is a beautiful experience to walk with God every day. I'm so happy, Jenny, that you have made an important decision by accepting Jesus as a Lord and Savior. How about each one of you?
The word salvation means being saved from sin and is essential to have a relationship with God while on earth and to have an eternal life with God in heaven after death. Jesus died on the cross, His death paid for all human sins and gave mankind the gift of salvation. Say this prayer by faith and invite Him into your heart. Lord Jesus, I need You. I open the door of my heart and receive You into my heart by faith as my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank You for the forgiveness of my sins. Take control of the throne of my life. This I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. It is our hope and prayers that we may not become caught up with the pleasures of this season, but let us remember to commemorate the birth of the Holy One of Bethlehem. The miracle child was born in a stable, cradled in a manger. He came forth from the heavens to live on earth as a mortal man and to establish the kingdom of God. This glorious gospel reshaped the thinking of the world. He lived for us and He died for us. What can we in return give back to Him?
your son down and set me free. Everything of this world will fade. I'm pressing on till I see your face. I will live that your will be done. I won't stop till your kingdom come.
Good evening, Honorable Bishop, respected members of the board, staff, and all our guests. It's my privilege to propose the vote of thanks for this occasion. First and foremost, I would like to thank God Almighty for the grace and mercy He has bestowed upon our institution and without which this program would not have been possible. I thank our Bishop, Right Reverend Dr. Prasanna Kumar Samuel, for bringing us the message and the good news of the Christmas season this evening. I also thank him for being a constant support and guide to our school. I thank the Board of Management for making this event possible and encouraging us in every way. I extend my gratitude to all the staff and students for all their hard work and effort, their dedication and drive to put this evening over the top. I thank our recording and technical team, Mr. Devin and Mr. Sam, for helping us in putting the whole show together. The commitment and devotion has certainly paid off. Today's choir was trained by Mr. Ashwin. We thank him for taking off his busy schedule and helping the students with their performance. Lastly, I would like to thank all the parents for all this encouragement and their support, for their constant cooperation during all the practices for this program. I cannot thank everyone enough for this involvement and their willingness to hand a helping hand in putting together this successful event. I thank you all for being a part of our Christmas program. Thank you. We wish you all a Merry Christmas and a blessed New Year.